The H2O Show on BBC Radio Solent.
Good afternoon, I'm Shelley, Jory-Leigh, and this week the programme is being recorded at the Island Sailing Club as the winners are announced for this year's Round the Island race. Well, we're here in the marquee of the Island Sailing Club. All the racers and guests and people are all here beginning to arrive for prize giving, so it's all getting quite exciting here, hustle and bustle. In the next hour, we'll be hearing from some of those who took part in this world-famous race around the Isle of Wight yesterday. And I'll be finding out how one of the biggest cruise ships afloat managed to get its way through the fleet. And away from these shores, another great ocean race came to an end this week. We're here from our local skippers in the Volvo Ocean Race.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1, time!
All clear!
That was the moment the race began yesterday morning, started by Natasha Lambert, or Miss Isle as we know her. A little earlier today, I caught up with the birthday girl to find out what the experience was like.
What a day yesterday. What did you actually do yesterday that most people sort of like dream of doing? And it was amazing, yes? Yeah. Mandy, explain what Natasha was doing yesterday.
Well, yesterday Natasha started the 2015 JP Morgan Round the Island race, yes. And it was absolutely incredible.
Natasha, how many actual starts did you do?
I think there was just one Natasha didn't start in the middle. She had a break, but apart from that, she started every single race.
I mean, what a spectacular view as well. I mean, you had the VIP box.
Ringside seat, yeah. It was absolutely incredible to see all the boats go over the starting line, every single one of them. Absolutely amazing. It was a beautiful day, excellent, lovely weather, and it was just an incredible sight.
Now, your actual first challenge, your first sailing challenge, Natasha, was sailing round the Isle of Wight, was it? Do you remember that?
That was an amazing day in itself, wasn't it? You had a fantastic time. So you know all the sights and all the different conditions that all the sailors had to sail yesterday, all the different points of sail. And
you're 18 now, Natasha, so huge, big birthday today. So happy birthday, Natasha. Let's just reflect slightly on Capital Venture, which is your latest big challenge you've just done. So you've moved on from sailing around the Isle of Wight. You do these huge adventures now, and we're raising money for the Sip and Puff Sailing School, which you're the founder member of. And Mandy, just explain to us what that's all about.
Right, Miss Isle School of Sip Puff Sailing is to enable other people with similar needs to Natasha to be able to go sailing, but not just to go sailing, to actually learn how to sail and to take it to whatever challenges they want to. So yeah, it's done with RYA instructors and based here in Cowes. And we think it's very exciting, don't you, Tash?
Well, it's been fantastic chatting to you. Happy birthday, Natasha. A huge honour starting the cannons of Round the Island race yesterday. Well done. And give us a call as soon as we've got another adventure planned.
Yeah, I think you'd just like to say thank you very much to the Island Sailing Club for asking you to start the Round the Island. It was an incredible experience, and to do it on your birthday weekend just topped it off.
And I think also somebody was, as she's 18, somebody was made a member somewhere.
You had a fantastic time after the starting the race. We had breakfast at the Island Sailing Club, and everybody sang happy birthday to Natasha, presented her with an amazing cake, some beautiful flowers, but one other very special thing. Natasha was made an honorary member of the Island Sailing Club.
Wow.
And that's an adult member, so absolutely incredible. Thank you very, very much to the Island Sailing Club.
Wow, Natasha Lambert, BEM, honorary member of the Island Sailing Club. How many more titles can you get? Well done, girl. Natasha Lambert chatting with me a little earlier this morning. This is the H2O Show. I'm Shelley Jory-Leigh, and I'm at the Round the Island Race prize-giving ceremony. Earlier this morning, I spoke to Giovanni, winner of the Gold Roman Bowl.
Oh, well, she's a very special boat. She was designed by Lauren Giles back in the late 30s, and she's the second of two boats which were built here on the Isle of Wight at Woodnuts in Bembridge. And she was launched in 1939, just before the war. and she's been used for mostly cruising, but also some racing. And I spotted her about 20 years ago in a reasonably run-down state, and I thought she was a stunning, perfect boat for me to play and go pottering in the Solent and for racing as well, because I thought she had a great hull shape. And we gradually worked on her and kept updating her with the latest and best sails we could, and kept improving our skills. And here we are, we won the Round the Island race.
Now, apart from your beautiful accent there, you're actually very local, aren't you?
Yes, I'm actually obviously an Isle of Wight resident, member of the Island Sailing Club.
And you sail here every Tuesday, you said?
Exactly, I'm here every Tuesday with our team, and we keep trying to learn and get beaten regularly on and off on Tuesday nights, but this has been a day in the sunshine, yeah.
I mean, it was a beautiful day, it was absolutely fantastic. So, who are the crew?
The crew are mostly the same old crew we had for a long time. They're old friends and guys I worked with, guys I sailed with, and just people we enjoy being with. And there's no... I mean, it's all like a homegrown team, really. We're mates that sail together, and most of... I would say half the crew only ever raced on Whooper. They didn't race on other boats, and we just really enjoy being with each other, with the families, and yeah, it's a really tight little unit.
How many actually crew were on the boat yesterday when you were racing?
We had 10, which is the highest number we've ever had. We've been up to 9. Now we managed to fit the 10th person, and there was no way I was going to let somebody off the boat, because, you know, it's such a fun race, you know?
So when you've got 10, how long is the boat?
She's only 39 feet and very low on the water. We're bringing her along in about 20 minutes. You'll see her, and she's a classic.
Yeah.
So she's very wet because she's very low freeboard.
And it's quite crowded with 10 of you on board.
Yes, it is, but they all know their spots. We all know our positions, and we're very well prepared, very well practiced.
Yeah.
And we enjoy it. That's what matters.
Now, not being a sailor, but I gather the weather was perfect conditions yesterday for the race. So how did the race actually go for you and your 10 crew?
Exactly. Well, we really, as I said, we prepared really well. We had a plan, a strategy, and we stuck to our plan, and it worked a treat, you know. We had a good start. We stuck to the lanes we wanted as far as tidal gains, and I was very lucky with some of the crew. They picked some very nice wind shifts, and we made some really nice gains up the beat, up to the needles. And after that, we just pushed her really, really hard. And poor old boat, she's 76 years old, but she's still reveling in it. And we pushed harder than anyone we could see around us, really. And we kept on passing boat, cutting corners here, trying to push all the way. And never looked back, sorry?
Do you know your actual time? Do you know what the time was?
Yes, we finished at 14 minutes past 3, exactly as I had planned.
Oh,
yeah.
Really?
We hit the schedule, yeah.
And so how many hours was that in total?
7 hours and 14 minutes.
Wow.
Yeah.
Amazing.
It's a good time.
And did you
our best time so far.
Did you know at that point you'd won?
No. Although it was a beautiful day, it was actually full on from the beginning to the end. Normally around the island you get several times when you get some slack where you can have a nice look around and enjoy the scenery.
And a cup of tea?
A cup of tea is totally out of the question on our boat. We were racing.
Always
we were racing as if it was a really short race. Yeah,
yeah. So brilliant. So when did you know you'd won?
We actually went in the bar alongside in our marina and drank as many beers as fast as we could while we were still leading, hoping that the small boats wouldn't come in, and we kept looking over and looking over and looking over. And we saw one arriving, then the result showed up probably about an hour after we finished.
Yeah.
We have to wait for the small boats to finish.
Yeah.
But
so, then you knew.
And then we had to drink some more beers.
Absolutely. Yeah. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Well
Thank you
done,
very much.
Giovanni. Fantastic. Congratulations to Giovanni and Whooper, winners of the coveted gold Roman bowl for this year's Round the Island race. Winners, but they weren't the first to cross the line. So how are the results calculated? Well, Neil's been finding out from the race safety officer, Dave Atkinson.
It's one of those things, it's always very difficult to try and explain to everyone. There are two ways. In some cases, the first boat home is the winner. But that is when you're racing is what we would term level racing. So everybody has a flat line. Everybody's got the same time. So, you know, if you take the GC32s, they're all exactly the same. They all come in as that. And we have other classes the same, that, you know, they all rate the same, so therefore they all, whoever's first over the line, they win that thing. The rest of it is where it starts getting complicated, where the majority of our competitors are. Every boat has what we would term a handicap, which is a time correction factor. And there are, we have our club handicap, the Island Sailing Club rating, and we have the National Authority, which is the IRC rating, which a lot of people use, and that is, you know, we always say to people, you go IRC. We appreciate that not everybody wants to go racing all the time, so we have a club one where people opt in just for the race. IRC is a secret formula, as is understanding clubs is a secret formula, but it is very similar. It is worked out on a number of factors: length, how much sail area, whether what sort of prop you've got, and everything else. All puts into this magical system in the computer, and it gives us a number at the end. So what we do is feed your time, your corrected time. So it takes you X hours, minutes and seconds to do the race. We then use that time, we multiply it by the correction factor, that gives us your elapsed time, your corrected time as what, according to your handicap, what you actually did. And that acts as a level-ish playing field. And I will be the first to put my hands up and say it's not perfect, because, you know, we're going by measurements that the owners give us, and it is very easy to get something slightly wrong, and a few inches here and something else there can make a huge difference. The only way you can get over that is have a measure your boat and everything else, but that's an expensive operation.
So when you've got, let's say for example, you've got 12 Clipper 70s out there, you may have 30 Sunsail 40s out there. They're easy because you only have to do it once and you can apply that across that whole range. But when you've got something like Eleonora, she's a one-off.
Yeah, that's where we have to be very careful that we get the right measurements to calculate the right sail areas and everything else. And we work really, you know, we administer the club rule here. Rourke administer the IRC rating formula because that is a national thing. And as I say, we always encourage people to go to that. If you're a racer, use that, because that's more accurate than we are. I'm not saying the club one isn't accurate, and we do compare data to see, you know, like, and how does our calculation work? And actually, we are reasonably close, but we don't profess to be 100% that. We can't be. You know, it's a free-to-air service, if you like, that we give to you as a competitor, so that you can compete in the race. So, you know, it's not a black art, but it's a formula that you take all these elements, put it together, to achieve that figure.
And all the skippers know the rules before they start, and they come back year after year after year, so something must be right.
Yeah, we must do a pretty good job, you know. And we always get the ratings thing is something that as sailors we all accept, but at the same time we always say, well, you know, I'm sure that's not right. And I'm, you know, my mate over there's got a so-and-so, and his rating's different to mine. But, you know, yeah, but that's what we do. But as you say, you know, we've got 1600 boats nearly out there doing it today, so they're happy.
So at what point do you know who the winner is?
Yeah, this is always the journalistic side coming out now. We get badgered from about 4 o'clock onwards. We normally don't know till 6 or 7, sometimes 8 or 9 o'clock. It just depends when that one boat, you can have one boat that will lead most of the day, and then you'll get something come in at the end of the day that's had a, you know, done really well, sailed better than their handicap, if you like, and they'll win. But that boat might not come in till 9 o'clock tonight.
Sounds like a really exciting job actually working it out, and because actually the person that's doing that is the first person to know who the winner of the Gold Roman Bowl is.
Well, we've got a technology system behind this that is, you know, second to none. You know, I have terminals here that I can go into a database and get all sorts of information, And I will be sitting in there because everybody will be driving me bonkers come the end of the day, who's won and what it is. I mean, well, we like to know. Let's face it. At the end of the day, we like to know who's won our race and everything else. You know, so we've got to get a clean set of results so we have a prize giving tomorrow lunchtime. So you know, that has to be good. But, yeah, end of the day, everybody is sort of sitting around saying, well, OK, who is it? And my phone goes and you know, everybody wants to know. The press office is on because the journalists want to get it in the news. You know, we want to get it out on the web. We want to get it. So, yeah. But believe me, you go from one mode to the other at the end of the day. So you've got everybody back. They're all safe. Right, who's won?
Neil Sackley chatting with Dave Atkinson from the Island Sailing Club.
H2O on BBC Radio Solent.
I'm Shelley Jory-Leigh, and this week H2O is in Cowes at the Island Sailing Club, where the prize-giving ceremony is underway. Presenting the awards is Paralympic gold medalist Helena Lucas, MBE, and I caught up with her before the ceremony began. Hey, Helena, what an honour to hand out the prizes for Round the Island race.
I know, it's absolutely fantastic. You know, it was a real honour to be asked, and yeah, I'm really looking forward to it. And I think, you know, I've competed in the race, you know, quite a few times now, so you kind of know how special a race it is, and you know what a long day it is as well. And you know, some of those smaller boats not getting back till sort of, you know, 9:30 in the evening. It's an absolute real achievement and commitment.
Why is it such a special race?
I think it's so special because, you know, you can have the most professional crew and the tip-top race boat, or you can be racing around in your little sonar or folk boat, and it just brings together professional sailors with amateur sailors, young, old, kids, families. It's a race for everybody, and everyone can enjoy it. And you know, I just think it's absolutely something that's really quite special.
I don't think there's another sport that you can actually do that, where you can actually have an Olympian next to you on a start line, is there? I can't think of anything where you can mix the two.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, I can't either. I mean, and that's what makes sailing so special, so unique, that you can have you can have someone who's, you know, the pinnacle of their sport racing against somebody who, you know, who's just a club racer, and that club racer might actually, if they're local, be that Olympian. So yeah, it is. I mean, that's what's so fantastic about sailing.
Now, talking about pinnacle of your sport, I gather you have already qualified for Rio.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm so pleased and so proud. I mean, I think last time round for London, I was almost the last person to get announced for the team, and this time, first person, first GB athlete to get announced for the team. So, yeah, brilliant. And it really means I can focus now on Rio, the venue, development projects and all that sort of stuff. So a lot of people say to me, you know, bit of a sigh of relief, you know, you can kind of, you know, take your foot off the pedal, but absolutely no way. It's kind of my whole program's intensified even more so now. So it's fantastic, but it's also completely full on at the moment.
Well, I'm going to let you go. You've had a really, really, you've had a busy day already. You need to get on now and get back training, girl.
Thank you.
Helena Lucas talking to me a little earlier. Well, Neil Sackley was busy yesterday pinning down skippers as they came back into the yacht haven.
Well, owner and helmsman of Invictus, Sir Keith Mills, you're born to be on the water.
Well, I'd like to be on the water more than I am, but I have other things to do in life, sadly, but Round the Island race is always a highlight.
And how was this year's?
Actually, it was great. With new boat, some new crew too. We're all learning how to make it go fast. And we did pretty well, I think. We're currently leading our class. A few more boats to come in. And we absolutely flew around the back of the island. And we had 21 knots downwind. And it's a bit of a beast to handle. It's very light and very twitchy, but then we had a great time.
Why do you think this race is so special? It has such a special place in people's hearts.
Well, I don't know many races in the world, if any, that have 1,800 starters today. And everything from folk boats and SP3s to, you know, classic yachts and multi-hulls. And it has everything. And the start line is always interesting. And it was for us as well. You know, it's just a great atmosphere, and this year in particular, we've had some great weather, sun shining, nice breeze, lots of great people, and some great racing.
What I think is lovely about it is you've got probably over 12,000 people taking part. It's 12,000 stories.
It is, and you know, we all have our stories to tell, and we're now in the beer tent exchanging those stories. But I mean, for everyone, it's a great experience. You know, it's a unique race. It's been going for many, many years, and I don't know anyone that doesn't do Around the Island and really enjoy it.
Well, one of the familiar sights on Around the Island race for many years has been Towing the Water. Lloyd Hamilton, skipper of Towing the Water 2 this year. How was the race for you?
Do you know, it was an absolutely brilliant race. Champagne racing again, as always, with Around the Island. We had an epic start. We were close quarters with most of the fleet as we left the Royal Yacht Squadron line. We enjoyed the beat down to the needles, where we competed in and against the likes of Invictus and a couple of other faster boats, which was great. It just proves the waterline length, and the old dog still has a bit of life in it yet. After that, we ran in the corner and we watched them disappear into the yonder and attain their great results that they got. For us and certainly for the injured guys and girls, it was immense. The opportunity to come out here and compete at such a large forum, around the island races, is always awesome. But and hopefully we're gonna end up with a top 100 result. So for the injured guys and girls, that whole thing and the whole ethos of Towing the Water, you know, team environments and the shared goal to win, hopefully we'll certainly be in a top few percent on the result board at the end of the weekend.
And obviously today being Armed Services Day, you are proudly flying the flag.
Absolutely, yeah. We ourselves, and we also had Invictus flying the flag today for the Armed Forces Day.
I saw that, yeah.
No,
yeah.
Absolutely. Keith Mills is a very big supporter, actually, of Towing the Water and the Armed Forces Day. And in fact, Armed Forces, hence Invictus, the Invictus Games. As a couple of our guys, actually, that were on today were part of the Invictus Games last year. But yes, Armed Forces Day is important. It's important for others to recognise the work that is done by the armed forces. You know, both in conflict, you know, and outside of. It's an immensely proud day for us to be thanked for what we do. You know, which is great. You know.
And this is your last Around the Island race, because Towing the Water is being disbanded. That must give you mixed emotions.
Well, it absolutely. You know, so there's times when I cry and there's times when I smile. The whole thing about Towing the Water, when we started in 2008, I'm one of the directors of Towing the Water. We started in 2008, and it was driven by the head clinician at Headley Court. You know, and we were required and we were needed. And one of the things that we wrote into our constitution very early on was the fact that when our number of injured servicemen and women became less than they were on Gulf War One, that we would cease to exist. And actually, that moment came at the end of last year. And we're now, as you rightly say, we're closing down, and we finish on September the 30th. But we're finishing with a flurry. We've had an amazing Round the Island race as our second to last event, and then we've got Cowes Week coming up in August, and we've got a massive party on August the 12th, which party like a pirate. If anybody wants to join us, it's going to be one of the most immense parties that they'll have ever been to, I can assure you.
Toe in the Water and Sir Keith Mills reflecting on their Round the Island race. Leopard Mike Slade. This is H2O Show on BBC Radio Solent, and still to come, we'll hear from the local jubilant Volvo Roche Ocean Race skippers, and I find out how a cruise liner negotiates the Round the Island fleet. And of course, we'll hear from some more of the competitors of the race. It's a race that puts Olympians side by side with day sailors, and Neil caught up with a couple of the Team GB squad ahead of the start. It's the first time that Giles Scott has taken on the race.
Yeah, it is. I've never been round the island, but I'm very excited about the chance to get round, and I think it's certainly something that every sailor should aim to do.
How familiar are the waters here?
Pretty familiar. I've done a lot of sailing in the Solent, but none round the backside. We'll just have to see how that goes.
Because you're both pretty much sort of at home at Weymouth and Portland, but here, I mean, the Solent is a whole different ballgame, Hannah.
It's a whole different ball game, yeah. You know, it's a very, very tidal venue, obviously. And Weymouth Portland has a bit of tide, but nothing like we have in the Solent. So I think it's going to be all about the tide, probably, for us, and getting our heads around that, ready for tomorrow.
Tell us about the boat you're on.
We are on an Open 60. Kindly, Volvo have invited us along, so with JP Morgan. So we're really looking forward to getting out there. And, you know, it's a much bigger boat than, obviously, we're used to sailing. So it'd be good to get a little bit of practice in before the start.
Yeah, I mean, this is a very different race to what you're both used to competition-wise.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, normally we're obviously racing in small little dinghies on short courses. So racing around in 60-foot yachts around an island is about as different as you can get. But the good thing about sailing is that a lot of the skills are very transferable. So, you know, we'll certainly be looking to try and get a good time in tomorrow.
And instead of half a dozen competitors, you've got 1,500 tomorrow.
Yeah, it's certainly a big fleet. And from what I hear, the start line is always absolute chaos. So hopefully we'll be able to escape from there.
Of course, I can't have you both here without looking ahead. It's 403 days now until the start of Rio. Somebody sat and worked that out. But you guys have got you've got the test event before that, of course.
Yeah, so in about a month's time, we head out to Rio for the test event, which is basically just a run-through of the Olympics for the competitors and for the organisers in the sailing event. So it'll be a great opportunity to get out in the waters, race against our competitors, and just see what's going on there, really.
No matter where the Olympics goes, there's always a lot of negative press on the run-up to it. Rio's been no different. How is it there, really?
It's OK. Obviously, Rio does suffer from pollution and litter, and that's what's, you know, that's been in the press a lot. But fortunately, a lot of our racing's done outside, and for us, it's just another sailing venue, and all the negativity is all part of the Olympic Games. But for us, we're certainly looking on the positive side and looking forward to some good racing.
Charles Scott and Hannah Mills talking to Neil before the start of the race. So let's hear from some more of the skippers and their crews here today.
Folks named Saddletramp.
Saddletramp, and you are?
Robert Bowler. This is my son, Adam, Mayor Bowler.
I'm Robert Whitten. I'm
and
Ben, nephew.
His brother there.
Okay, so you were all sailing together, so an all-male crew.
Yes.
Who was in charge? The little one?
I was in charge. Rob did cooking. Adam was sort of floating, weren't you? But good, you were good. And navigating around the back of the island, weren't you?
Yeah.
You got the charts out, weren't you? And navigating, marking off and stuff, yeah.
How old are you?
11.
So you're actually... Can you do the charts and everything and plot it and everything? Really? 11? That's amazing. And did you enjoy it?
Yes.
Where was the best bit?
Probably coming around the back of the island where we were just overtaking, like, racing.
Was it rough or was it lovely and flat?
It was rolly, but it wasn't rough and it wasn't flat.
David Robinson, what happened at the start?
We had a very good start. We were about two boat lengths from the line. Unfortunately, we were the wrong side of it, so we ended up with an OCS 5% time penalty.
Oops.
It didn't help.
So you were a naughty boy at the start.
I put it down to crew failure, but they insist it was my fault.
And the name of your team?
The three-boat team is the Aran Yacht Club Light Brigade.
Well, I found one of the prize winners, and he is a very young man. William, first of all, how old are you?
I'm 16 years of age.
And what have you won?
I've won the Raymarine Young Sailors Trophy.
Did you all have to be of a certain age on the team?
Yeah, we had to have 50% of the crew under the age of 18, but we had actually more than 50% under 18, so that was actually quite good for the team, basically.
And how was it out there?
It was a really good race, actually. We had about 15 to 20 knots, and it was quite exciting, especially from the Needles to St. Catharines, but... apart from that, yeah, it was a really good race.
Well done, William. Extremely good good effort, and well done for winning that trophy.
Very well done, thank you.
Well, it's real hustle and bustle in here. We've got prize giving with some amazing trophies that are going to be handed out. There was over 1,500 boats set off from the squadron line yesterday morning to take on the 50 nautical mile race around the Isle of Wight, and it was incredible conditions. The harbour master closes the channel for the start of the race. But once all the boats are underway, the Solent actually returns to normal. And that means commercial traffic, leisure sailors and race competitors all sharing a very busy channel. So how does a cruise ship get through the fleet safely? Well, yesterday afternoon, I joined the Southampton Harbour Master patrol boat, Spitfire, as Caribbean Princess tried to make its way through the fleet. Quite honestly, it's chaos. We've only been out here half an hour. We are currently judging a situation between the Caribbean Princess and a small sailing yacht that's finishing round the island race. The Caribbean Princess has actually had to do a tighter turn and put the power on, so they've probably lost all the dinner plates off the restaurant now. We're just going to speak to
Gary Olden here, who's the marine officer on board the Spitfire. Gary, what actually was happening in that sort of chaotic situation?
Yeah, the yacht was struggling with the tide and he was being swept down to the east, so we had to get him to start his engine and sort of proceed as best as he can, fast as he can, more to the west, so the Caribbean Princess had more space to turn in. So the pilot had to turn a little bit tighter than what he would normally like to do.
It still looks quite close to me, where, you know, bearing in mind we're looking at a massive cruise ship.
Yes, the yacht shouldn't be anywhere near the ship in theory, but we obviously allow a little bit when the big race is like this on, but that was a little bit too close, really. You know, we like to keep them at least 1,000 metres away from these ships when they're manoeuvring in this area.
I mean, I wanted to sort of start the programme calmly, but to be honest with you, there is so much going on. You've got eyes in the back of your head. Nigel is up there. Nigel Lanning is our coxswain, and he's driving. And you two literally are doing 360 circles all the time. Is he going to make it? Are they going to make it? I'm exhausted.
Yeah, you're constantly judging and anticipating what they're going to do and what the ship's going to do, who to leave, who to turn back. So it's a constant game of juggling the yachts, making sure they're going to be safe whilst these ships are manoeuvring in this area.
Right, it's 5:45 in the evening. Round the Island race is sort of coming to a close. Just explain to me the situation we've got here on the water here, if you can. I can see you're still looking everywhere. Because this is the first of many. Well, we've already bought one container ship. We've already delivered a pilot onto one container ship. This is the first cruise ship. What else have we got?
We've got a very large container ship, what we call Cat 4. It's 360 metres long. She's our next job. She's just coming around the cow shop now. And then we've got another two cruise ships to go yet. Yeah.
Okay, we've got the captain, the pilot of Princess Caribbean talking to Nigel, our coxswain, up here.
He was looking okay, so he's
okay. Okay, yeah, he's clear ahead of you anyway.
Yeah, he's good.
Okay. Just a little concern there. Barry's carrying on his turn now and going north of the ride. But as you can see, he's got a wall of sail in front of him now.
What was the concern there, Nigel, that little yacht?
That one would look like he was okay, and Barry's turn went a little slightly wider than I think he thought, and it was just some concerns that he might be in the way, but he's gone clear now, so he's happy.
What amazes me is the teamwork between all of you, because you are now very close to that cruise ship. I mean, we are nearly under his bow, but that pilot on there is completely aware of you know what you're doing.
Yeah, he totally relies on our manoeuvrability in front of him and our awareness of where he is. And he'll voice any concerns he has with any yachts and ask us to go to him if he doesn't think we've seen it.
Right, we're now looking at a wall of white sail, and that cruise ship's going through it.
Me and my whistle will take you from here. You're going to see if Chris wants assistance, mate.
OK, cheers, Barry. See you next time, then. Best of luck.
Thank you.
So now, yeah, Barry's now happy. He's going to go come round the port a bit more where it's a bit clearer, and he's happy that he can blow his whistle and find his own way through this sail. He's more concerned about the container ship, and we get back to that now. So we're going to go full speed ahead to get in front of the container ship.
That's Gary Olden, who was my skipper yesterday on board Spitfire, as we guided Caribbean Princess safely out of Southampton and through the competitors in this year's Round the Island race. So how does the race actually come together on the day? Well, Dave Atkinson explained the logistics to Neil.
Oh, it's a mammoth task for us. I mean, you've got 160, 170 people out on the water today making it work. A year-long process to, you know, get to what, to a day. And all the things we have to do with it. It is a mammoth task. We're getting quite good at it, though, but you know, we refine it every year. We learn from each year.
Well, I mean, this race has been, well, we know this is the 84th. It's not 84 years, but the 84th race, of course. Now, come Monday, do you then start with a complete clean sheet and think, right, well, what can we do now?
Obviously, we learn a lot. I mean, as you say, this is the 84th race. We've got a lot of learnings over 84 races. So we always have a debrief of everybody end of next week. So I think it's Thursday we have all the heads of department come, we all sit down, what worked, what didn't work. We then, over the next couple of months, formulate a plan, if you like, it's probably the easiest way to put it, as to what we need to look at over the winter months. And you've got to remember that we have to produce a notice of race in January, so actually we've got 6 months to refine the things. So we probably look at our learnings internally, and we have a competitor questionnaire, and we go in depth into those sort of things. What are our competitors saying? You know, what are our customers saying? What do they want to see with the race go? Where do they want to see it go? Any refinements we can make, and we put all that into the mix at the end of the day, and then we move forward to, you know, planning next year's race.
Because obviously one thing you can't change, because nature had a hand in it, is the course.
No, the course is what it is. There's always, you know, things that happen where, you know, sandbanks move, you know, we have to deal with obstacles that put on our path by things that we can't do. I mean, you know, at the moment we're talking about Perpetuous around the back of the island, and we're in discussion with that and have been in discussion with that for a long time, so that's a concern that we've got. We've got over that, we've got a good understanding with them, so, but it's something that over the next couple of years we're going to have to work with. We're going to have to sort of work with everybody about that, so it just adds a new dynamic to what we actually do. And we do big tweaks, but big tweaks take time, and from my perspective, with a safety hat on, we'll only make a change if we think it's safe, because the last thing we want to do is cause any issues. The last thing to do complications or put people's lives or, you know, at risk. We pride ourselves on the safety of the race. We strive every year to deliver a safe race to our competitors, and that's the number one. If I change this, how it does that affect the safety of the competitors? And you have to bear in mind the game that we play. There are two elements we'd have no control over, and that's the wind and the tide. So, you know, we can legislate, we can do all the planning, and then we get what we get on the day, and that's the one thing we can't do. So there's a lot of times we do, it is a guess. So it's best guess estimate based on the previous year's weather and everything else. Is this going to work or not?
In terms of safety, I mean, how close does the buck come to you? Because it has to be the skipper's final call as to whether they go or not.
Ultimately, it is the skipper's final call. We have a system here, we have a steering group, which manages the race and is responsible to the general committee and the club to manage that race. That group meets every month, and then at times when we need to do extra work. So that group is made up of people with a lot of experience in the race. I mean, this year's my 30th. You know, I've got 30 years of things that in the back of my mind, and everyone says, well, why don't you write a manual how to run the race? You can't do it, because you can't cover all the things. A day like today, when we've got incidents and things going on, it is purely your experience going forward that says, okay, we've done this before, do we need to do it again? Can we refine it? So you could say, yes, safety-wise, the buck stops here. And in some ways, that's a pretty big call on me and the team. But ultimately, the crews and the skippers have to take a certain amount of... I cannot say that boat shouldn't go, because I don't know the capabilities of that boat. I can only take general comment and general, you know, this should happen, that shouldn't happen.
But let's face it, Dave, this is one event that tens of thousands of people look forward to every year. They'll be putting next year's date in their diary today.
Oh, we publish the dates 5 years and ahead. You know, we are grateful to, you wouldn't believe, that we're the only place that we can actually shut the Central Solent down. Cowswick can't do it, nobody else can do it. Around the Island Race, ABP and all the local authorities we were really close with, and they allow us a two-hour window when they actually say to the commercial shipper, and you've got to remember, Southampton, it's where they make the money, but they allow us to shut the Central Solent down, to start the race. And we're grateful, and we couldn't do it without that help.
Finally, Dave, when is next year's race?
I knew you were going to ask me. I can't remember the blasted date. I'm very sorry.
Neil Sackley chatting with Dave Atkinson from the Island Sailing Club. And by the way, Dave, next year's race is on Saturday, July the 2nd. We're at the Island Race prize giving here at the club in Cowes, and there's 78 prizes are going to be awarded today. Helen Lucas, MBE, is doing the honours. Some of the trophies actually have quite a history to them, and Laura Mills has been telling me more about the trophies that are going to be presented today.
What is that one? That's the Dean and Redihoff trophy. It's actually got a block inside that came from Ellen MacArthur's boat, B&Q,
that she had
when she did her world record attempt for the solar circumnavigation
in
2005. Yeah.
That's in that sort of glass mould there.
That's the bit that's inside there, yeah.
And then obviously this is like a glass globe of the world.
Yeah, that's the world to show you where she went.
Hey, amazing. Right, let's move along because there's some lovely ones down here.
This one here.
Yeah.
This is the Leonard Bloomfield trophy. He was a member of the club and he passed away a couple of years ago and he left us some money. So we decided to get a trophy in his honour this year. So that's a new one for this year, which is going to the GC32s.
That's why it's very shiny.
It is very shiny, yeah. Actually, they're all very shiny. We have a little team of polishers that come in just before the race and they sit here on the Wednesday and they get everything out. They polish it, they wash it, they do all the silver, all the gold and all the woodwork for us.
Now, some of these trophies are so valuable they can't leave the club, can they?
Yeah, there's six of those. We've got the gold Roman bowl, the silver Roman bowl, the silver gilt, the Royal Thames, the Conrad Ritbat and the Observer trophy. So because they can't go, they're given a JP Morgan Asset Management salver that they can take away for the year just so they've got something to show that they did win something.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, what's that little one down there? That's cute. Oh, I like that, the Shamrock
That's
trophy.
That's the Shamrock trophy, yeah. This came from the planking of Shamrock 5, and it was presented in 1976 by the crew of, I think that says Giovata.
It is, yeah, Giovata. That's really cute. That's like a little wooden cleat with the ropes all wrapped around it. I love that, because that actually doesn't look like a trophy. It looks more like a bit of a doorstop, doesn't it?
It does, yeah, yeah.
A very elegant doorstop.
What's this one? This is relatively new. We've had it for a few years now. It's the Tenacity Trophy. We decided that the last person round to finish within the time limit, so up till 10 o'clock at night, the very last person to go through the line gets this one.
Is that the booby prize?
It sort of is, but it's just recognising the fact that they've kept going and that they've done it. So we always give a prize for that now.
Is it true that Sir Robin nearly won that once?
I don't know. I honestly don't know.
I think he did. Just in comparison, how many, I mean, all these, not in comparison, all these trophies here, how long does prize giving take?
We try to do it within 45 minutes.
You must just throw them at them.
Well, the thing is, there's so many people here that want to go home. They want to get their boats back to the mainland. Yeah. So we start at 12 promptly and we try and get it done within about 45 minutes. Right. And also the staff have had a long weekend, so they all need to get away as well and get a bit of sleep.
You need to get to the pub, Laura.
We do need to get to the pub, yeah.
Now, just quickly, because I want to talk about the one on the end, which is one that can't leave here, but this is lovely. Do we know what that one is?
That's a new one for this year. It's a Contessa one.
That's
and it's
beautiful.
A lovely picture of a Contessa boat.
It's a model of a yacht in a frame, isn't it?
Yeah.
Contessa 26, 40th anniversary commemoration trophy, first round the island race.
Yeah. So that's a new one this year.
So that will go.
Well, it's new to us, but like most of these, they have a history.
Yeah.
So there's quite a lot of history on the back for other things they've used it for. So yeah.
Fantastic. Right, let's move to the creme de la creme. This is the
gold Roman bowl. Again, this one can't leave the club because of the what's one of the valuable ones that has to stay here, so it gets the salver as well.
So just explain to me about this gold Roman bowl.
The base, it's made from old timbers from HMS Victory. So, and then this little cup, this lovely cup that sits on the top, is a replica bowl of an ancient Roman bowl that was found in the Thames, hence why it's called the gold Roman bowl.
So is there a value on that trophy?
I don't know. It's too valuable. It can't leave here. It has to be locked. These and the silver gilt and the silver get locked in a special cabinet the rest of the year, and they're not allowed to leave here.
Oh, I don't want to touch it. That's fantastic. Thank you, Laura. I'll let you get on because you have got one big prize giving to get through in 45 minutes.
Thanks very much.
Laura Mills from the Island Sailing Club. This week I'm in Cowes at the prize giving for Round the Island Race, and more from here shortly. This week, of course, is also the Volvo Ocean Race, and it came to a thrilling climax in Gothenburg in Sweden. After 9 months and 35,000 miles, the Hive-built boats have completed their first race. Abu Dhabi Ocean Racing skipper Ian Walker.
I spent a year not daring to look at the trophy. It's my only superstition was to never, ever touch or look at the trophy. And now I've done both. I think we could do it now we've won. But, you know, what makes it special is sharing it with all the guys in the team. Everybody's worked so hard, not just the guys on the boat. It's everybody in the team. And I hope everybody gets to lift that trophy because they all deserve it.
Yeah, I was a nightmare on the first stage into The Hague. And
So yeah, I just decided that actually I just needed to calm down a bit. And yeah, we just had a very relaxed leg and actually it went quite well. You know, we caught right up with Matt Frey and Brunel and Don Fong. Thought we might even get a piece of them at one point. But, yeah, you know, it was a special moment to be able to do those miles in such nice conditions with no pressure at all and just savour the moment.
And now America as well, coming in first position, taking the first. I mean, have you got any comment on that? Because I know that you're a big supporter of Charlie and the guys.
Well, I know they deserve it, and if I could have chosen one boat to win that leg, it would have been them. Now that means six of the boats have won legs in the race, which is incredible and speaks volumes for the standard of competition and speaks volumes for the one design rule. And I have to say, it's all very well lifting that trophy, but the trophy means nothing if you haven't sailed against the best sailors in the world. And I really want to congratulate everybody we've raced against. We've had some incredible battles with very tight finishes, and I think we've all made ourselves better sailors because we've had to be in order to beat the others.
Victorious Wasatch skipper Ian Walker, winner of the Volvo Ocean Race, speaking as he docked in Gothenburg this week. And it was an emotional finish too for our other local skipper, Sam Davis, on board Team SCA.
It feels amazing. The welcome was incredible. I haven't seen so much pink all the way up the river.
It's magenta.
All the way up the river, it was amazing. And yeah, I'm really proud. We've accomplished something amazing. And all the girls have been fantastic. And I don't think we've realised it's finished yet. Right now, I'm just really tired.
So the last part of leg 9 of the Volvo Ocean Race, again, you were having a battle with Vestas. You couldn't quite, there was a little bit of a jostle, but you couldn't quite take them at the end of this leg.
No, but it was great. We thought we'd be able to catch up, and we managed that. So that kept us motivated for the race. And it was great to catch up with them. We did overtake them for about 5 minutes. we thought they were being gentlemanly, but they weren't. And then we had a really good race to the finish. And I think that's how we'll remember the Volvo Ocean Race, is sailing so close to the other boats. For us, I think wanting to be that close to the other boats, not quite managing it. But finally we have, and the last couple of legs we've been up there, and that's going to be our memory, and that's how we're going to come back to do the next edition.
Sam Davis, looking ahead to the next Volvo Ocean Race. Congratulations to all of those who took part, and we'll be hearing from Sam's teammate and H2O presenter Dee Kafari during Cows Week. You're listening to the H2O show on BBC Radio Solent, and we're at the Round the Island Race prize giving here in Cowes. Let's hear from some more of the crews who took part in yesterday's race.
So fresh back from doing the race, it's Cowes Racing School. James, skipper, how was it?
Fantastic. A whole lot quicker than last year. It took 11 and a half hours to go around last year, and we're just shy of just over 6 hours this year. We won our division last year, which is fantastic. This year it looks like we're in fifth place, so in our division. And we're not sure yet overall, because there's still a lot of boats to finish.
A quick race this year, but not the quickest.
No, not the quickest. There's a lot of tide we had to battle against all the way around the south side of the island. So that constantly held the speeds down. But it was great fun at on the south side. There was lots of wind, downwind sailing, and... Yeah, it's great fun.
Forgive me for putting it this way, but you're a race veteran. How does this rank compared to other races that you've done?
I think this was the 25th time I've gone around the island. This, what I say, was right up there in one of the sort of almost into the top five, I think.
Well, Sun Sail, based in Port Solent, well represented in Round the Island race once again. Mike, your first mate's on board here. How was the race for you?
Well, it was really... an enjoyable race. The first half up to the Needles was tactical and very competitive. We were second and third, but managed to make it first to the Needles. And then we had a wonderful run down Spinnaker Leg to St. Catherine's Point and run down to the fort. And that was fantastic, but we had some troubles after that. And
what happened?
Well, we're not quite sure, but we were overtaken by the boat from behind us, and we tried as hard as we could, but they just came past us. I think it was a tide wind thing. They got a really nice wind shift, and perhaps not as much tide as we were expecting them to get.
There's always a big entry from Sunsail. Do you find that there is a sort of almost an in-race race?
Oh, absolutely. The boats are very competitive because they're all one design and you're not allowed to change the sails too much or anything like that. And so they're competitive and it's tight one design racing, very tight.
Cowell Sailing School on one of the Sun Sail entries, talking to Neil as they finished the race yesterday.
And the last trophy on my list is the Gold Roman Bowl and JP Morgan Sail for first overall IRC. Ladies and gentlemen, a local boat again, which gives us a great pleasure to present this trophy. The Laurent Giles one-off.